So my name is Donald Robertson, and some of you may know me from the face group, Stoicism group that I run, and from the online courses, which I'm the moderator for. So I kind of do some of the technology stuff, and e-learning is one of my areas, but my background is in psychotherapy and cognitive behavioral therapy, and originally in academic philosophy. I studied philosophy and got from that into doing therapy. And it's incidentally, somebody, I don't know if you know this or not, but we originally started off all in this country, and then I moved overseas. I emigrated to Canada, so I'm on a flying visit from Nova Scotia this weekend. So Stoicism and love, that's what we're going to talk about today. And this is rather an unrehearsed workshop, so we'll need to have a look and see how the timing goes. We've not done some of these exercises before. So what I'm going to do is just talk a bit, and then I'm going to get you guys to have a bit of a discussion. Now, I mainly want to talk just to give you some pointers for discussion and maybe give you some quotes. I think this is a kind of controversial area. And as we were saying earlier, I mean, a lot of people just think Stoicism, love, they're just two things that don't really go together in their mind. And that's why we wanted to do it. And John and Chris earlier were talking about the emotions and that dimension of Stoicism. I don't know how intentional it was. It just seems to have happened that this year the event has got that as a bit of a theme in some ways. And it's partly to address common misconceptions about Stoicism, I suppose. So one of them is that Stoicism and love are just two things that don't sit comfortably together at all. So we'll have a look at that, and I'll give you some quotes from the Stoics, just so you know I'm not making it up or something like that. If you read Marcus Aurelius or Epictetus, you'll see that they say various things about love. And then I'm going to get you to have a wee discussion, so I'll split you into groups, if that's okay. It's always a bit tricky in a lecture theatre, so you can't move around much, but I guess you can just talk to the people that are around you, and then I'll kind of, in a slightly haphazard way, I'll skim round and just see if I can get some comments or questions or thoughts from each of the little groups that we have, yeah? It would be much easier if we could put you in round little tables or something, so I have to be careful I don't miss anyone, but you guys will keep me on track, hopefully. No hiding at the back or anything like that. So I'll try and divide it up a little bit, and then hopefully we'll have time to do a couple of contemplation exercises as well. So if you've been doing, I think it's the Thursday part of the Stoic Week handbook is about relationships and is similar to this. And there's an exercise in there that everybody says is like the metta-bhavana or metta-bhavna exercise in Buddhism. So I'm just going to kind of tackle that head on, and we'll look at that exercise and see if we can just adapt it and make it fit in more with Stoic themes. And we can have a discussion about that. So again, not spoon feeding or anything. I'm going to give you stuff and you guys can evaluate it for yourself. And you can make of those exercises what you will as well. So first of all, I wanted to recap some of the things that Chris was saying earlier. And also there's some overlap with what John was saying about emotions as well. Chris Gill mentioned that some modern commentators, and I think he mentioned Richard Sarabji and Martha Nussbaum, questioned whether there's much room for love in Stoicism, which they describe as involving detachment from other people. And I think it's fair to say that there aren't many people who say there's no room at all for love in Stoicism, but there may be some people that think it plays a negligible or a minimal role. And he notes that this wasn't a criticism that was commonly leveled against the Stoics in the ancient world. The Stoics, I would say, saw themselves, and I think were generally perceived by other people, as a philosophical school advocating a kind of affection for the rest of mankind, bound up with what's often called a philanthropic or a cosmopolitan attitude. And those are some of the things that we've mentioned already. And Chris noted that the Stoics do challenge us, nevertheless, to love others in a way that's brutally honest and realistic about their mortality and our own. And that's really the fundamental thing here. I'm going to come back to that full circle. You know, love in Stoicism has got to be a bit different from the way that people conventionally think of it. You know, so there is a lot of emphasis on love, but we wouldn't expect it to be unchanged by the whole set of values and worldview that we find in Stoicism. And part of that is, what does it mean to love a mortal and to do that in a kind of brutally honest and realistic and rational way? So accepting also the transience of relationships in general, And the fact in the ancient world that people might be separated by travel or by warfare, and our lack of control over other people, which I guess is the fundamental thing. You know, that I can't think of a better example of something that we don't have direct control over than other people. Jean Paul Sartre said, "Hell is other people." Maybe a slightly more gloomier perspective than the Stoics. But that's a good example of something we don't have direct control over, but that we have to interact with other people. So on the one hand, many people, and possibly even some academics, assume that Stoicism and love are either incompatible or somehow kind of in conflict. On the other hand, for instance, Marcus Aurelius, in the very first chapter of the Meditations, describes the Stoic ideal as follows. He describes one of his main Stoic mentors, tutors, Sextus of Chirona, as being free from passions and yet full of love. Now, that's going to confuse the hell out of people that think that the Stoics by passion mean stuff like love. Like, so obviously, whatever they mean by it, they don't mean the same as what they meant by love. And most people, if you ask them, name a passion, they might say something like love. Yeah, Stoics are contrasting these. They're two completely different things in their mind. The Stoic ideal, the wise man, the sage, is full of love. Not, you know, that he has some role for it. He's full of it. And yet free from these irrational, excessive, or unhealthy passions. And those are the three terms that the early Stoics used to characterize the passions, the bad passions. I think he later uses the same expression, actually, further on in the Meditations to describe his own goal in life. So perhaps also modeling his tutor. Marcus also says that he should love other people, not just superficially, but from the very bottom of his heart. So it's also clearly not just at least in Marcus, it's not just some sort of intellectual exercise. He means that he wants to train himself and learn to love the rest of humanity in a very profound and a very demanding way. He's not mucking about with this concept. So he seems pretty serious about it. Cicero is one of our other main sources for understanding of Stoicism, although he wasn't a Stoic himself. He was very sympathetic to Stoicism and tells us a lot about it. Cicero explicitly says, the Stoics actually both say that the wise man will experience love, and they define love itself as the effort to make a friendship from the semblance of beauty. Now, that's slightly confusing, but I think what clarifies it perhaps is there's a theme in the Socratic literature in general, including the Stoics, that says that true beauty is basically virtue. So Socrates, Plato describes as being not a physically beautiful guy. He was pot-bellied and had a pug nose. But the joke was, they used to joke about the fact that he had this kind of inner beauty that shone through because he had virtue. So making friendship from the semblance of virtue, perhaps, and choosing friends that we see at least the seeds of virtue in, and loving people because they're virtuous, or because, I'll probably come back to this in a moment, they at least have the potential for virtue. And I think the Stoics would say everybody, or all rational beings indeed, have the potential for wisdom, justice, courage, self-discipline, and virtue, flourishing in that sense. So a kind of inner beauty is the basis of this affection, which exists in all of us to some extent. So the Stoic potentially loves all mankind in that sense, and he also particularly loves his teachers and mentors. Indeed, to start with, I'd just like to point out something that's a kind of mystery in broad daylight here, which is obviously the word philosophy means love of wisdom. And, you know, that's not a trivial thing. The Stoics, I think, take that very seriously and take it very literally. Wisdom is the cardinal virtue. It's the supreme virtue, really, for the Stoics. And they certainly, I think, would describe themselves as loving virtue. And I think we can relate to that as a theme in Stoicism. Virtue is obviously the most highly prized thing in the world. Indeed, the supreme healthy passion, John spoke earlier about the healthy passions in Stoicism, the eupatheiae, they describe as rational joy or chara. It's basically a kind of rejoicing in the presence of virtue. John talked a little bit about that earlier. So ancient Stoicism entailed rejoicing in virtue and literally loving wisdom. So that's another aspect to it. And I think those themes are pretty clear. In fact, I only had a chance to do this quickly, so you guys can double check it when you get home if you like, or during the coffee break on your phones. I got a couple of translations of Marcus Aurelius because I just suddenly thought, let's just do a word count. And I looked for words like virtue and wisdom, and he actually, those words are in the translation surprisingly few times. I think in one translation, the word virtue was only came up about 12 times or something like that. So we could probably do a more sophisticated search and maybe find variations of it. But the word love, I looked at three translations of Marcus's Meditations, and it was found between 40 to 60 times, which is a lot. And that confirmed my perception that he bangs on about it relentlessly, really. And, you know, it's kind of amazing that anyone would not notice the fact that he's banging on relentlessly about love and lots of different aspects of love. It's kind of, you know, in all of the sections of the Meditations, he has something to say about it, and he says quite a lot of things about different aspects of love. The Stoic literature is really full of these references in the other Stoic writers, maybe some more than others, Marcus perhaps in particular. But they talk about love, friendship, affection, and that there's a kind of cluster of interrelated concepts. As John also mentioned, there's a problem of translation here, because in Greek there are a number of different words that could be translated as love or might be translated in different ways. And the Stoics also use some kind of neologisms. They use this word philostorgia, which is kind of hard to translate, but it means sometimes it's translated as natural affection or familial affection, and it clearly means a kind of love. And friendship is a closely related concept in the Stoic literature. So they tend to be very emphatic about it, as in that quote from Cicero. But here's a quote from Seneca as well that, you know, just confirms this yet again. Seneca says, "No school has more goodness and gentleness than the Stoic school. None has more love for human beings, nor more attention to the common good." And he seems to think that's uncontentious, that, yeah, the Stoicism is the school that really emphasizes love for humanity. And I think that was a fairly general perception in the ancient world, although perhaps even at the time there might have been people that questioned the nature of that love. And, for example, the Epicureans maybe would have understood the role of love for others and friendship in a slightly different way. So what I'd like you to do is just have some initial, you know, I don't want to talk for ages and then leave all the discussion to the end. It's always a bit of a circular process. We need to give some examples and then have some discussion. But really, I want you to have a bit of a chat about it between yourselves. And if you could try and split into groups of maybe, you know, five or six each, does that sound doable? Maybe just with the people that are sitting around you? Just because, if possible, I'm going to go around those groups, so we don't want to have too many, and I will keep it quite brief and, you know, giving some comments. So I'll give you a minute to organize yourselves, and you may want to move seats. Chaos ensues. Okay, so I'm just going to let you kind of settle in there, you've got to do some introductions and stuff maybe. Okay, so I'm going to give you questions to discuss, yeah? So listen carefully, because what am I talking about? You could just talk about it in general. I don't know, what, like 5 minutes or something for this, and I'll give you two questions to discuss, yeah? We'll see how it goes in terms of time. So I don't have slides, so I'm just going to read out what the questions are, and maybe somebody can write them down, or you'll probably remember them. The first one is, what do you think Marcus Aurelius means by being full of love and yet free from passions? And the word that he uses for love there is philostorgia, or natural affection, would, you know, be perhaps a more literal translation. What does he mean when he says that his tutor was full of love and yet free from passions, that's something that he wants to aspire to? And the other question is, what role do you think love on natural affection play in Stoic philosophy? And, you know, do you think those are related concepts, or, you know, are they different, are they the same thing? How do those two concepts relate to each other? Or, you know, just even the terminology, if you're not familiar with the literature. To what extent does love or natural affection actually play a role in Stoicism? I'd be surprised if you say it doesn't. That's going to be controversial, given what we've said already. But, you know, have a think about it, and, you know, how important is it, and what do you think its role is? Could you have a stoicism that kind of overlooked it, for example? Do we sometimes underplay it? What do you think? So I'm going to give you, let's say, about 5 minutes to do that, and then I'll go around and get some comments from each of you, so be prepared for that, to have some feedback. Any quick questions before we begin? It's basically the passions are emotions and desires that result from faulty value judgments, basically. And so they're mainly consist of irrational desires and fears, and also taking pleasure in things in a kind of irrational or unphilosophical way. As John said earlier, what they mean by the passions, they tend to be characterized as excessive or out of control compared to what we would perhaps think of as other types of feelings or emotions. Does that help? Bit of a tricky thing, but yeah, okay. Okay, go, do philosophy, rapid philosophy. Right. We want answers, people. Give you another 5 seconds. Okay. Right, stop. Time out. Okay. So we have got a lot of people, haven't we? So I don't know if we can go around everyone, but maybe the best way to do it would be to do a kind of show of hands, and then I'll take comments from you. I'm probably not going to answer questions at this point, but if you have questions, share them with everyone, and maybe we can then come back and you guys could discuss them, or we can respond to them a bit later. So put your hands up if you've got some thoughts, comments, or questions from that discussion. Nobody? Excellent. Okay, this gentleman over here. Yeah, you moved, you saw you blinked.
Uh-huh. Of all beings, and in a very cosmological point of view. And I personally felt that it is what Brother David Stendhal Russ said, it is an existential yes to belonging.
Oh, that's what we want. Existential love, cosmic love, big love we're talking about here.
Where the passion goes is kind of in a very separatist, reductionist, excessive way of looking into things, uh-huh. which takes us away from that cosmological point of view and togetherness.
Maybe love is... passion maybe is narrower in scope and has more to do with attachment, possibly in stoicism. Right, who's next? There were some other hands at the back there. Or have you changed your mind? You're recanted. This gentleman here in the middle.
Yeah, we agreed in the group, gave you the conclusion that the love that the sage is experiencing is something more altruistic.
Yeah.
And the passionate love is something more akin to actually falling in love to someone. Uh-huh. Like there's a big difference between having an altruistic desire of helping people and liking people and like wanting them to have a good life.
So passionate love, I might call that sometimes romantic love when I'm talking about it, a way of kind of describing it. And we'll come back to that actually very shortly. Who's next? This gentleman here.
We'll try shortly. It's always a very strange feeling when we try to theorize love,
yeah.
which is supposed to be, of course, a living thing.
Yeah.
Now, Marx Aurelius said love as natural affection,
uh-huh.
and something came in my mind like love as natural state,
mm-hmm.
which, of course, it's not a technical thing to be acquired through repetition or training. You can't be trained to love.
Yeah.
So if you cannot be taught love, it has to be something within you or not at all.
Uh-huh.
So how can you get there?
Yeah.
So probably getting rid of the passions and which is maybe the ego, as we all know it. We can call it like this or in other names, and allowing the love to be as it is, love, and being recognized as love.
It's a natural thing.
A natural state, natural affection. I mean, what could be more natural than this?
Exactly.
So, we can keep going.
That was good. That was good. Okay, anyone else? Let's spread the love. We haven't had anyone over there. Say this gentleman here.
We're struggling with the definition of both words.
Right, yeah.
Well, the word love isn't the way we would immediately think of the word love in English.
Yes.
And the word passions isn't the way we would immediately use the word passions in English. So
yes.
Therefore, really, the whole question needs to be rephrased in what they actually meant.
Yeah. Well, part of the process, actually, that you're engaging in is perhaps trying to clarify those definitions.
I think part of that, what the definition is, I think has been discussed here. It seems to me to be a little bit, it's not philia, it's not eros, he's talking about storge or maybe agape, which are sort of Greek words that would kind of, but I'm still struggling very much, we were still definitely struggling with what the Stoics meant with passion.
Well, I think it helps if we look at these things in context. So if I give you some more quotes and we just kind of work our way through stuff, that's an inherent problem. And scholars will struggle and disagree over the translation to some extent. But at the same time, when people read Marcus Aurelius, I think they get a sense of what he's talking about. Although sometimes the language can get in the way. What he's not talking about. We all have to work through that process. So, okay, one more maybe, and then I think we'll look at some more of these context-providing quotations. Did you want to comment?
The first question, which was, how can he be full of love and free of passion?
Yeah.
Well, the two things are sort of mutually exclusive. So as long as you have passions, you're unable to genuinely love. And if you remove the passions, then genuine love is all that is remaining.
I think that's what the Stoics might want to say, yeah. Yeah. You may not agree with that, but I think that might be something they'd agree with. Is there anyone else that had a comment they wanted to make that they haven't had a chance to make? No, okay, and you'll get a chance. Oh, this lady at the back, yeah.
We talked about unconditional love for children and family, didn't we?
Yeah.
And we had a slight discussion around whether you could still make judgments out of passion that were wrong for such a close family member. In other words, that these feelings could get out of control as well, even though they were born out of the purest natural affection.
Uh-huh.
And these feelings can be exaggerated beyond making wise decisions, just as trying to keep a platonic love going.
Yeah.
And I was quite interested in the word platonic because I felt that it came in with what Marcus Aurelius was saying, that to remove, and you made the point, didn't you, that if one gets too hung up on emotions such as lusting after people and not having that detachment, you could be making wrong decisions.
Yeah, yeah. And the parental love for children is integral, as we'll see in a moment, to what the Stoics are talking about. That's a kind of prototype for understanding love. I'll explain why, perhaps, in a moment. But even that affection has to be filtered through reason and wisdom to be the type of affection or love that the sage experiences. Okay, with time check, we're about halfway through. We've got about half an hour left. So we'll see how we got. I might curtail some of the discussion just so that we've got room to do some of the contemplative exercises. We'll see how it goes, yeah. So just to kind of give you some more quotations to chew over. Although some people perhaps read the Stoics in different ways on this point, Pierre Hadot, who's one of the most popular scholars in this area, thought Stoic philanthropy and cosmopolitanism were very similar to the Christian notion of brotherly love. He said, it cannot then be said that loving one's neighbor as oneself is a specifically Christian invention, because the Stoics came first. Rather, it could be maintained that the motivation of Stoic love is the same as that of Christian love. He's implying it precedes it historically. Even the love of one's enemies is not lacking in Stoicism. Now, actually, I've heard some scholars dispute that or question it, but it clearly is there in the Stoic literature. For example, here we go. Marcus Aurelius wrote, it is a man's especial privilege to love even those who stumble. And this love follows as soon as you reflect that they are akin to you and that they do no wrong they do wrong involuntarily and through ignorance. and that within a little while both they and you will be dead. And this above all, yeah, don't worry, they'll be dead soon. And this above all, that the man has done you no harm, for he has not made your ruling faculty worse than it was before. This is a big Stoic theme, and it's a Socratic theme. You can't harm me unless you harm my character, unless you can't take away my virtue. The final sentence of the handbook of Epictetus is a quote from Socrates that says, Anytus and Melitus can kill me, but they cannot harm me, which weirdly is pretty much what Obi-Wan Kenobi says in Star Wars. What does he say? You will only make me stronger, or something like that. Not quite what Epictetus and Socrates meant. I wonder if that was what influenced it, though. So the Stoic loves other people because they are his kin, according to Marcus, as citizens of the cosmos and as rational beings. Everybody is brothers in that sense, and sisters. What if they don't love us back, though? The blighters. Like, the Earl of Shaftesbury, who's an early modern philosopher who's you should read if you're interested in Marcus Aurelius, because he basically, you know, does his own version of the Meditations, and it's fantastic. I mean, you know, it's awesome, as we say in Canada. I figured out the Canadians say that things are super if they like them, or awesome, but they never go so far as to describe something as super awesome. What if they don't love us back? So the Earl of Shaftesbury wrote that Stoic love was disinterested, as he put it, and not dependent on reciprocation, and that's fundamental to it. He puts it as follows, come on, let us see now if thou canst love disinterestedly. Thanks, my good kinsman, brother, sister, or friend, for giving me so generous a part that I can love, though not beloved. There's a nice passage in Seneca, I'm trying to compress this very much, but there's a passage in the ninth letter of Seneca where he says that the Stoic wise man naturally prefers to have friends, and we talked a little bit earlier about the difference between preference and desire. He prefers to have friends, but he doesn't need them in order to feel fulfilled or contented. And that's actually quite a good illustration of this distinction. So he naturally prefers to have friends, and he sets about having them, but if for some reason he's denied human company or friendship, he doesn't feel that he's denied something that's essential to having a good life. He just has to exercise virtue in coping with that. That doesn't mean that he's completely indifferent to it. Socrates sought out friends, and Zeno sought out friends and students, but he wasn't dependent on having them for his happiness, which is a kind of interesting paradox in a way. Okay, so I'm going to give you another couple of questions to consider following on from that, and here they are, so you might want to jot them down. Number one, how does love for others in Stoicism, how do you think it compares to love for others in Christianity, or in compassion in Buddhism, or brotherly love in other philosophical or religious traditions, perhaps? You know, like, given that Haddo has said this is like Christian love, well, is it, isn't it? You know, how do you think it compares to that sort of idea? I want to emphasize that because, you know, sometimes when people are talking about Stoicism, they think their idea of love is a sort of strange, alien concept. And you might say, well, it's as familiar as the Christian concept of love. You know, it might not be identical to it, but it's not a crazy idea. You know, there are lots of Christians around the world that share a similar conception of brotherly love. And the other question is, how does Stoic love compare to the way that romantic love, or passionate love, we said earlier, is portrayed in, I don't know, like what, in Hollywood films, or I'm trying to think of one, or romantic novels in rom-coms, like by Jennifer Aniston, or whatever, you know, any other celebrity type film, you know, or, you know, in art house films or whatever. But, you know, in Mills and Boone novels, I've never read one, right, but I'm assuming maybe a set of cliche or something. But in Hollywood films and rom-coms and kind of cheesy novels and stuff, you know, is there a sort of popular conception of passionate or romantic love? And how does that relate to what Epictetus was talking about? I'm guessing it's different. Like, I want you guys maybe to think about how different it is. So first of all, how does it compare to things like Christian love or karuna, compassion in Buddhism? And how does it compare to what we see in the movies and in novels and things? Any quick questions before we get started? Okay, I'm going to give you 5 minutes to do that and then report back, beginning now. Okay, just a few seconds remaining. Just finishing up. I didn't have to do it that time. I've got you conditioned already. Right. So, first thing I'd ask is that if there's anyone who hasn't already asked a question and they have something, just so that we give everyone an opportunity, is there someone who hasn't asked a question already that has a comment or a question from the discussion that they'd like to share? Yes, this lady here. Thank you. Gosh, I'm not sure if they do, actually. Not in the kind of more formulaic approach, but Marcus Aurelius uses a slightly wider vocabulary than Epictetus does, for example, so he may do. Not that I'm aware of, though. But so maybe that's something to kind of look into, check out. Yeah. They have quite a rich vocabulary, technical vocabulary. Okay, any other questions, comments? This lady here.
It's just a point of clarification from your last, what you were talking about. Yeah, I mean, if a character is in disrepute or his virtue is in disrepute, okay, then is it, just to clarify, that stoicism or is sort of that situation is worse than death for him? Is that?
Yeah.
Yeah. That's what I thought. But then how can that be true of a stoic if it is that he's not dependent on, you know, preferences of friends or these kind of situations to be happy, when actually if he can look in the mirror and say, well, actually, you know, I did the right thing, it doesn't matter whether I'm in disrepute or not, then he is a true stoic.
Oh, sorry, disrepute. His character was vicious.
So if it was true, so okay.
Yeah, it doesn't matter what other people's opinions are. But if he was dishonorable or vicious in his character, that would be worse than death, basically, for Stoics. His reputation is an indifferent. In fact, it's a key example of an indifferent social status. That's down to other people, essentially. You could be a good man with a bad reputation. Yeah. Happens to me all the time. next, another question. Over this side, maybe. This lady.
I was thinking an interesting difference. Would a Stoic ever die for their beliefs?
Yeah. They did.
So, it's a Stoic martyr. Doesn't that go against the Stoicism of self-preservation and self-love?
Yeah, it becomes complex, but I'll give you a very short answer to that. It would take me a long time to give a proper answer to it. But the Stoics believed that our self-preservation instinct should evolve into an instinct to preserve the integrity of our character and the virtues. So they think it goes through a kind of evolution as we progress towards wisdom, and therefore wisdom and virtue become more important than preserving your life. That's a very abbreviated version, basically. There's a good discussion of that in Cicero's De Finibus. He puts it in the mouth of Cato, who did die as a Stoic for his beliefs, incidentally. Okay, anyone? Yep.
That's the big difference.
So can't argue with that.
Stoicism is for human beings.
Yeah.
Buddhism, you know, Stoicism is atheist.
Can't argue with that either.
Buddhism is atheist.
Altruist, did you say?
No God. They don't have
atheist. God. Right. Stoicism isn't atheist.
That's a very big difference.
Yeah, well, the Stoics weren't atheists.
God,
the Stoics weren't atheists. They weren't atheists. They believed in Zeus. In fact, that leads us nicely on to the next, if you don't mind.
Love for Christians, uh-huh, is love for Christ and yeah, in Christ.
Uh-huh.
That's a big difference.
No, the Stoics were theists. They're pantheists. Okay, they believe in Zeus.
That's my opinion.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. But it's not true that they didn't believe in the gods. Not at all. I mean, Epictetus bangs on and on about the god Zeus, definitely, on, you know, every discourse. So, if you don't mind me continuing, we just to do a time check, we've got about 15 minutes remaining, so I just want to move on and then go on to the exercise. Maybe we could discuss this more in the interval, if that's okay. Okay, so the Stoics emphasize the concept of natural affection, which is the kind of love a parent has for their children, fundamentally, and that's the basis of their ethics. And Shaftesbury calls this attitude extended to everyone as fellow citizens of the cosmos, Stoic philanthropy. And he writes, what is it to have natural affection? Not that which is only toward relations, but towards all mankind. To be truly philanthropos, philanthropic, a lover of mankind, literally. Neither to scoff, nor hate, nor be impatient with them, nor abominate them, nor overlook them. And to pity in a manner and love those that are the greatest miscreants, those that are most furious against thyself in particular, and at the time when they are most furious, which is a rather charitable conception of love, and it's similar also to the passage that we just saw from Marcus Aurelius. He compares this attitude of natural affection for mankind to the loving attitude of a mother or nurse towards a sickly child, and particularly a sickly child, because the Stoics think that miscreants or people who are misguided in a sense are suffering from a kind of moral illness or psychological illness. The Stoics often sought to emulate Zeus, or God, as their ideal, and the paternal affection Zeus was supposed to have for mankind as his children, as the father of mankind, they wanted to be godlike in emulating Zeus in that respect. And Musonius Rufus, the teacher of Epictetus, describes the Stoic Zeus as the patron god of friendship and of familial affection. And so they see Zeus as being their guide in this regard. So for the Stoics to be philanthropic and to love mankind as one's brothers and fellow world citizens is to be godlike, in a sense. Musonius also famously argued that women as well as men should study philosophy. So it's probably going too far to call him a proto-feminist, but some people have said he does say some things that other philosophers don't say in that regard. He claimed that Stoicism would actually make women more able to properly love their children rather than somehow repressing their affection. But nevertheless, for our purposes, that's an interesting point. He says that, you know, in order to love properly, you need to have the virtues of Stoicism, he said. Not that Stoicism represses love or affection, but, you know, only Stoics can do it properly, apparently. He says, who more than she, a female Stoic, would love her children more than life? Which is an interesting way of putting it. Indeed, there are several places where Stoics suggest it would be fundamentally unnatural to suppress feelings such as parental love, and therefore irrational to do so. Epictetus actually says, quote, when a child is born, it is no longer in our power not to love or care for it, which is interesting given the distinction that he makes between things within our power and not, and how central that is to his philosophy. it's natural for parents to care, for instance, if their child is hurt, he says, is one of his illustrations of that. And that relates to, I think, some things, again, that John was saying earlier. We actually have a whole discourse by Epictetus dedicated to the subject and entitled Unnatural Affection for Storgia. This natural affection, though, is clearly somehow changed in Stoicism. Actually, to come back to one of the points that was made earlier, it's transformed, as is the affection that we have for ourselves and our own self-preservation. Epictetus asks his students, very bluntly, how then shall I become loving and affectionate? So he says to his students, as a Stoic, how do you love? Like, how do you exhibit affection? And his answer is that you do it by acting consistently with the fundamental rules and doctrines of Stoicism. Surprise, surprise. In particular, we're to love while bearing in mind the distinction between what's up to us and what isn't. So in order to have rational love, as opposed to irrational or kind of excessive or unhealthy love, the difference between healthy and unhealthy love is bearing in mind what's under our control and what isn't. And that probably relates back to what we said earlier about loving even though it's not reciprocated. And so being loved isn't under our control, but loving others is. And again, that would make Stoic love kind of philanthropic by its very nature, or kind of generous, charitable. He also suggests that if what we're calling love or affection makes us enslaved to our passions and miserable, then it's not good for us. And it's a sign that something's wrong. So he's kind of saying, love shouldn't hurt. Like, in that sense, it shouldn't destroy us. Like, true love, shouldn't be a destructive force. It shouldn't be a corrupting force. And if it is, it's not proper love. He would say it's something that isn't even worthy of the name love. It's an obsession or a fixation or something like that, if it destroys or corrupts us. And to put that differently, to put the same thing differently, for those of you who are familiar with the jargon of Stoicism, he seems to be saying we should love in accord with the reserve clause, as it's sometimes known. So we should love other people by wishing that they flourish while accepting that it's not under our control whether they flourish or not, and that they may become vicious, and accepting that if it happens, in the Stoic sense of acceptance, basically. So accepting other people, warts and all, while at the same time wishing for them to flourish. And I think, I have to be very concise about this, but it's a big point that I'm going to leave you with, to think about before we do the little exercise. It seems to me that there is this kind of conflict or paradox in love. I mean, what does it mean to love somebody? What does it mean to love your children or your spouse or a boyfriend or girlfriend or whatever? And on the one hand, love can be seen as being about acceptance. It's about accepting people, warts and all, despite their imperfections. And that's in Stoicism, because the Stoics believe everybody is insane. There's this odd thing about the Stoics is none of them claim to be wise. None of them actually claim to be sages. Even Zeno, as far as we know, didn't claim to be a sage. But he said that everyone that's not a sage is nuts. And there's an interesting illustration of that in Seneca. He says, I'm not wise. I'm like a sick man in a bed discussing my treatment with the guy in the bed next to me. Like, not in the same bed. That's the guy in the next bed along, right? So the Stoics are kind of humble. They're not setting themselves up as gurus in that respect. With the reserve clause, I mean, on the one hand, love is about acceptance, I think, isn't it? But it's also, isn't it, about wanting people to flourish and wanting the best for them, wanting them to become wise and strong and healthy, while accepting if they're not. And that's a kind of paradox. But funnily enough, that's the central paradox of Stoicism. Like, one of the central strategies in Stoicism is this balancing act between preferring certain natural outcomes while accepting the fact that sometimes it's not fated to be. Everything is, the reserve clause is basically like attaching the caveat, fate permitting, to everything. So I would like my son or daughter to become wise and strong and courageous and virtuous, fate permitting. And if they're not, if they fall short of that standard, I love them and accept them anyway. So it's wanting these two things that on the face of it seem slightly in tension. And the Stoics do a really good job of reconciling that. They answer one of the difficulties, one of the paradoxes of love, I think. And the other question I'd ask you That's another big question. Apologies for kind of, you know, dumping all this philosophical stuff on you. But they, it's possible to understand Stoicism as basically a philosophy of love. You know, could we approach Stoicism as basically fundamentally a philosophy that attempts to conceptualize love? I don't think that's as crazy an idea as it might sound. I don't think it would have sounded at all crazy to the Stoics themselves. So, metabhavna in 5 minutes. I think we can just about do this. We're going to take this exercise, and I'm going to ask you to prepare yourself for it, first of all, by thinking of some examples of people. And the first one in the Buddhist exercise, normally you think of yourself, and then you may think of someone that you love, like a close friend or a family member, someone that you would have affection or love towards. And then someone that's neutral to you, like a shopkeeper or somebody that you've just, as a casual acquaintance, that you don't have love or any negative feelings towards. And then maybe someone you dislike, or maybe someone who acts in a dislikable manner towards you, who it would be difficult or challenging to love, an enemy, you know, for want of a better word, if you can think of that. Someone who's difficult to love, at least. And then we imagine them as a group, and then we imagine extending that feeling to the whole of humanity. But I'd like you to see if you can approach it using some of the Stoic ideas that we've been talking about, and maybe for those of you who are familiar with this exercise, to think how it compares. So if you want to take a moment, let's just say, if you close your eyes and just make yourselves comfortable, and just attempt to visualize this in your mind's eye and contemplate it. So take a few moments just to relax and turn your attention inward, if you will. And focus your attention on yourself, first of all, because the root of natural affection in a way in Stoicism is our relationship with ourselves. Our self-preservation instinct is how it begins. So focus on yourself and imagine cultivating a feeling of love and affection towards yourself, a rational self-love. And again, think about this Stoic reserve clause. Could you wish that you will flourish while simultaneously accepting yourself as perhaps being imperfect or flawed? So can you accept yourself as you are while wishing lightly, preferring that you flourish in the future? Wishing the best for yourself, wishing that you're well. And you could do that visually, if you like, by imagining a white light or a colour that perhaps symbolises those feelings, and maybe spreading through the body. And you might say something to yourself, for example, may I flourish and be happy, or may I become virtuous and wise, may I flourish and be well. And just using those words to kind of help you get into the mindset, the attitude. And now, if you could perhaps imagine someone that you love, maybe a family member or a close friend, and imagine expressing, developing, cultivating those attitudes of affection towards them. Maybe picturing it again as a color or a light, and perhaps using words like, may you flourish and be happy. May you flourish and be well. So just trying to get into that mindset of a rational, a philosophical kind of affection towards the other. You know, while accepting that they are beyond your control. And then imagine a casual acquaintance, maybe someone that you feel kind of neutral towards. And could you imagine developing a more of a philosophical attitude of affection, brotherly love perhaps towards them, a philanthropic attitude, wanting them to be well while accepting that it's outside of your control if they flourish or not. And could you extend that perhaps even to somebody you dislike, or someone who acts in a kind of objectionable manner, someone who's difficult to like? Imagine it as a colour or a light, and perhaps say to yourself, may you flourish and be well, may you flourish and be happy. While accepting if they don't, or even do the opposite, accepting that as the reality, while wishing for them to improve. And then imagine yourself and the others as a group, a small group, and imagine that attitude extending throughout the group. Yourself, a loved one, a neutral person, and a dislikable person. Imagine the light spreading around you as a group. And perhaps saying, may we flourish and be well, may we flourish and be happy. And what would be the most rational or philosophical way of experiencing that attitude of benevolence, kindness, affection? And then imagine it expanding beyond that small group to a bigger group, to the community around you, the world, the country around you, the whole of humanity. Progressively expanding that in your mind. What would it be like to have that attitude unconditionally towards the rest of mankind, regardless of whether they're likable or dislikable in their behavior? To aim to love others in this philosophical sense, even if they don't reciprocate. Just to explore that in your mind, visualize a light spreading, or repeat to yourself, may we flourish and be well. Okay, now we're going to have to conclude the exercise, so apology for doing a kind of rapid contemplative exercise. But I really just wanted to give you a little bit of a flavour of that. You know, if we had more time, we would have maybe spent 10, 15 minutes going through that a little bit more systematically. So we've looked at some quotes, we had a bit of discussion, and we've got a little bit of a flavour of a contemplative exercise. I think it's three, so I'm just going to maybe spend 1 or 2 minutes taking final questions, and then we better wrap up for the break. So hopefully we compressed quite a lot in. I hope it didn't seem too rushed for you, but I wanted to give you as much as I could, a kind of mixture of discussion and practical stuff as well. Any quick thoughts, comments, questions before we conclude? Probably in 30 seconds I'm not going to answer like one of these dissertation type questions about the nature of Stoic ethics, but
it's been a broader question, but
yeah.
One word I've heard a lot today is rational.
Yeah.
And that instantly worries me. And I'm not sure I'm clear, because for me philosophy change with rationality.
Uh-huh.
You know, around the time of the Enlightenment. Yeah.
Yeah. They do talk a lot about reason and the.
I don't really know what it means when you talk about the Stoic, yeah, being a rational being, and you told us in the contemplation to consider a rational response.
I think the simplest way to, again, I'd have to be very concise in my answer to that. I would just say, you know, think about what it would mean to be irrational, you know, and what the alternative to that would be. That's my short answer. I mean, certainly reason is integral to Stoicism, and it's one of the overarching themes. But there may be different conceptions of reason or rationality. That's true. Maybe that's something that we could return to later in the latter part of the day when we're doing the panel discussions. Well, okay, I'll take one more quick comment or question, and then we better have our break. This lady at the back here.
How would you extend Stoic virtue to moral corruption?
That's a biggie. Why? No pressure. How would we extend Stoic virtue to moral corruption?
In what sense? Yeah. And you know it was morally corrupt.
Uh-huh.
And yet
you were don't do it.
Expressing,
yeah. I guess the Stoic would try to remedy the situation insofar as it's under the control to do so, and while accepting that there are corrupt people in the world and it's not always possible to stop them or educate them. I mean, but the fundamental Stoic strategy is to try and enlighten other people, though, and make them wise rather than just kind of punishing them for the sake of it. Now, that's the Socratic attitude towards crime or corruption, if you like. So again, it comes back to the reserve clause, wanting to enlighten and educate and reform people while accepting that it's outside of our control, ultimately, whether they change. The classic example of that was that Socrates had wayward students and children and a wife, allegedly. But although he's the ideal of reason and wisdom, that some of the people around him, he couldn't prevent their behavior from becoming corrupt. Okay, let's finish there. That concludes our big love fest. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. I love you all.